At midnight, there rose a shout. The bridegroom is coming. Come out and meet him. Let us pray. Gracious God, we say thank you for blessing us to see another day. We invite your presence to be great in our midst, and may we feel your presence and your power. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, let's worship the Lord together and tell him thank you for all the blessings he sent our way. Thank you so very much to our fountain singers with your anointed voices. We're just so grateful to be in the Lord's presence and to celebrate it with you. I'm Pastor Anderson again, and we're just so grateful to have all of you with us on this, the Lord's Day. You know, the Bible says this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. You know, as we're getting ready for this message, you can't help but think about all the events that have taken place in our week. And it reminds us of something that is so important in all of our lives, is that we need to be ready. So today I want to talk to you from this passage of scripture. It's a parable that Jesus teaches to his disciples. Remember, a parable is a earthly story that has a heavenly meaning. He is now sharing with him the nuggets of the kingdom and how important it is for us to be ready when he comes. Listen to the word of God out of Matthew's gospel, the 25th chapter, verses 1 through 13 from the New Living Translation. The kingdom of heaven will be like 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish and five were wise. The five who were foolish didn't take enough olive oil for their lamps, but the other five who were wise had enough to take along extra oil. When the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, they roused by the shout, "Look, the bridegroom is coming. Come out and meet him." All the bridesmaids got up, prepared their lamps. Then the five foolish ones asked the others, "Please give us some of your oil because our lamps are going out." But the others replied, "We don't have enough for all of us. Go to the shop and buy some for yourselves." But while they were gone out to buy oil, the bridegroom came. Then those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was locked. Later, when the other five bridesmaids returned, they stood outside calling, "Lord, Lord, open the door for us." But he called back, "Believe me, I don't know you. So you too must keep watch, for you do not know the day nor the hour of my return." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. I want to talk to you today about let's be ready when he comes. Let's be ready when he comes. It's amazing that this parable is one that teaches us some timeless truths about life and about living. Remember, Jesus was trying to prepare his disciples for his departure and for his return. They were wanting to find out, when are you coming? When shall you return? So Jesus gives them a parable, something that they could identify with. See, a wedding in their day were different than the wedding in our day. In our day, whenever we go to a wedding, most commonly, you will see the minister or the officiant along with the groom standing waiting for the bride. And whenever she comes down the aisle, the wedding begins. It was different in this day. During this day, it was a part of the patriarchal period. And it was that these marriages were pretty much arranged by families. And the bridegroom would frequently be coming from a distant land, would be coming from someplace other than around the corner or being the around the way person. And so what happened was they would be prepared and ready because many times he had to travel some distance. And so he begins to remind us that what happens is that the bride and all of her bridesmaids were waiting and watching and getting ready for him to come. So he begins to share with us that the Lord's return would be similar in that very same fashion. It lets us see that it helps us to understand that this is a parable that talks about five wise and five foolish. It reminds all of us that we have to be wise in how we live our lives. The Bible talks about wisdom in the wisdom literature that we find in Psalms, Proverbs, and Ecclesiastes and Psalm of Solomon. It's where we begin to find out the wisdom that God wants to impart to all of us. When you and I read the Word of God, whenever we read the biblical text, and when we extrapolate and pull from it all the great nuggets of truth, it is then that we begin to find wisdom. The Bible tells us if you want to see wisdom, go to the ants. Look at how the ants work. They all work together as a team and they know how to store it because they know winter is coming. It reminds all of us, as in this text, these bridesmaids, there were five who were wise. The wise ones decided that we will get our lamps We will have enough oil that when we start, there'll be full, but we'll bring some extra olive oil. But there were five who were foolish. These foolish bridesmaids, I'm not sure if they had any relationship to the wise ones. It seems as though they may have come from very different backgrounds. And because of that, they were not prepared. Sometimes we can think their preparedness might have been they really didn't think through what was about to happen to them. Many times you and I, we really don't think through some things because if we did, we could be better prepared for what's about to happen. All of us have to think through and we all have to plan ahead. It is always taught to all of us whenever we see wisdom in the Bible. It talks about if anybody is about to construct something, anybody's about to build a house, anybody's about to build a barn, you need to first of all determine how much will it cost. Then how much materials do you need? And when do you need the materials delivered? Because everyone knows you start out with a solid and a firm foundation, and then from there you build up. Well, these foolish bridesmaids in the text, they find themselves not bringing extra oil. Remember, it was already night. They didn't know what time he was going to come. And so what commonly happened in their day, you would turn the wick down to the lamp so you wouldn't have it fully up, so you wouldn't use a whole lot of oil. Even as they turned it down, they found out that their lamps went out. They were very different between these five wise and these five foolish. And notice, the foolish, they didn't have enough oil, which says to us, they lacked some planning. In all of our lives, we need to plan. One of the things that all of us have to understand, just as we plan for a birth, we must also plan for all the other events that take place in life. It's exciting how all of us, when we get ready to plan, and it's that time of year with COVID-19, it's a little bit different. But many of us, we will be preparing and planning for Thanksgiving celebrations. It's exciting because this is the second Sunday in November. And all of us know that that means we're right at 2 weeks out from Thanksgiving. It helps all of us think about Thanksgiving because Thanksgiving is a time that most of us know that it's going to be time for shopping to get ready for Christmas. But now we find out there's so many deals that you have online and many people are not going to the big box stores and all of us decide how we want to buy what we want to buy. You plan for it. But if one decides I'll just use whatever plastic, whatever available credit I have, you also have to be able to plan how to pay that bill off. So it's important for us to plan. The five wise bridesmaids, they were so smart that they decided we will have enough oil, but we'll take some extra because we don't know how long it might be before the bridegroom comes. This text helps us to see and understand that the bridegroom was delayed. And in the process of his delay, it meant that time began to get away from them. And they had to keep their lamps. Their lamps were still burning. It reminds all of us and those of us who have been diligently studying in school, diligently studying late at night. Remember, we used to use the phrase burning the midnight oil. That's a phrase that came from the days in which many of our parents and grandparents, I know my parents studied by lanterns and by lights because they came from a rural part of North Carolina and Georgia before they came to North Carolina. And they had those lamps. And it's so amazing that even in the storage room at what was my parents' house, we still have that old lantern that came from Georgia. It was one that you put oil in it. And you had to really understand how to turn up the wick and how to turn down the wick to maximize the flame and to make sure you had enough light during the middle of the night. My parents used to tell me that the way they used to do it, they would turn the wick down so there would be a night light. In our contemporary times, we have all sorts of night lights. We have the kind that you can plug into the wall and that they were dim, they were brightened up, so you can make sure you see where you're going in the middle of the night. But these wise bridesmaids, they were prepared. They had not only the oil that they needed, but they brought a little extra. The text lets us see at midnight, there came a shout. The bridegroom is coming. Get ready. Now all of them are scampering to get ready. And in the process of getting ready, the five who were not wise realized they had run out of oil. But those who were wise brought some extra oil. So the five who were not so wise, they asked them, can we use some of your oil? But they had to think about it and said, no, if I give you some of mine, we will both run out. That lets us see and helps us to understand that there are people who live this life, who begin this Christian race, who begin this race of life. Some of them run out of oil because they did not bring an ample supply. It's amazing during this pandemic, so many people have found themselves saying that I'm burnt out. I find myself being excessively tired. It is important for all of us to realize that all of our strength, all of our help has to come from the Lord. And in this text, we can see that oil becomes somewhat of the imagery of being ready for when God comes, being prepared, knowing that we have done all that we need to do to be ready when he comes. It says at midnight, there was a cry that says the bridegroom is coming. So all the bridesmaids find themselves scampering, trying to get dressed, trying to get ready. And those who were not so wise found out they didn't have enough oil. Their lamps had gone out and they couldn't make their way to the wedding feast and the celebration. The text lets us see the wise tell them, I don't have enough for you. So in the meantime, the foolish ones, they find themselves going to shop. Going to find some oil. Can you imagine late in the midnight hour trying to find out somebody whose store is still open? You know, many of us can remember the days in our lives that 8 o'clock, 10 o'clock, many stores closed. Midnight, it was definitely shut down. I remember as a child, the TV would go off right after the news. But we must remind ourselves, they probably had to search in the dark to find a place to buy some oil. So it lets us see and it helps us to understand that because of them not being ready, they wasted some time. When you and I don't prepare ourselves, many times we are wasting our time. It is important for us to be prepared to know what is going to happen. I don't know about you, but I grew up in a household. My parents used to always tell us, think about and have an idea. And even better yet, take out your clothes that you're going to wear tomorrow, tonight. Have you ever had a situation whereby the lights went out and you didn't know what you were going to wear? Well, everything black and blue looks the same color when it's dark. And then you can find yourself not matching up. So here in the text, it lets us see and it helps us to understand that while they were out shopping, something happens. The bridegroom comes. They now go into the wedding feast. As they go into the wedding feast, it is now that they're part of the celebration, and we must understand there are traditions then are much different than ours today. And so in that setting and in that text, we find out that they are having the joy and all the laughter of the wedding celebration. And then all of a sudden they hear a rap outside at the door, and the one who's the keeper of the door hears the knock. And as they knock and say, please let us in, we are a part of the celebration. And he replies back, believe me, I don't know you. This becomes a parable for all of us to understand. That the text helps us to know that those who were wise, they were prepared when the bridegroom comes. This parable is about being prepared and being ready when Jesus comes. It is our belief in Christianity, and it's in our belief that the Lord is going to do just what he says. We find in the gospel, according to St. Matthew, after Jesus had been crucified, after he had been buried, after he had been resurrected, he spent about 40 days with his disciples. And then after spending that time with them, he left them. The angel said, just as you see him leaving, he's coming back again the same way. And so what happens, this becomes an illustration, a parable, a life lesson to remind all of us, just as the Lord went away to heaven, he's coming back on earth to claim all of his children. The Bible tells us in John's gospel and in the 14th chapter that Jesus says, I'm going to prepare a place for you, but I'm going to come back and receive you unto myself because I have mansions. I have a dwelling place that is prepared for you. I have a banquet like one you've never seen. He begins to share with us this illustration of a marriage because Christ calls himself the groom. And we who are the believers in Christ, we are known as the bride. He's coming to be ready to call us to himself, to have the wedding celebration, to have the feast. This parable helps us to understand that Jesus is coming back. And the illustration of those who were wise are those who were prepared and ready, that when the Lord came, they were ready to go into the banquet. But notice in the parable, it says that those who were foolish didn't have what it took to go, so they went out trying to buy something to get themselves in. This becomes a clear illustration that we cannot buy our way into heaven. We cannot earn our way into heaven, but it's simply because of what Jesus did for us at Calvary's cross. The parable says that they will come knocking on the door saying, please let us in. And he will say, I don't know you. It is important for all of us to make sure that we know God, that we have a relationship with Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and we have the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. It is then he reminds us to be ready when God calls for us to come home. Oh, one day Jesus is going to come, and I want to ask you, will you be ready when he comes? I have to ask myself the question, will I be ready when he comes? I can remember as a child, and before we had transportation like many of us do today, whenever you had a ride, my parents said, anytime somebody is kind enough to give you a ride, don't have them waiting on you, but you be ready when they come. I can't help but think about that. That prepares me for the insights of this parable. It says, let us be ready. How can we be ready and know that we're ready when he comes? Well, I think there's some things we can do. One of the things that we have to do is we have to make sure that we have confessed our sins. God, forgive me of my sins. Those sins that I know about. Those sins that I don't know about. Forgive me of my sins. Then secondly, Father, not only forgive me of my sins, but teach me to forgive others in the same way you've forgiven me. Remember that prayer that we call the Lord's Prayer? It's really the prayer that the Lord taught his disciples. Forgive us our trespassers as we forgive others of their trespasses. It lets us see that there's a direct relationship of how God forgives us and how we forgive others. Because if truly we have the love and the forgiveness of God in our heart, we can forgive other people as well. Now, forgiveness does not necessarily mean you don't remember, but it means that we choose not to bring it back up. So we find out from this, and it helps us to understand that there will be those who will be knocking on the door and he'll say, I don't know you. They were out trying to buy something to be ready for when the bridegroom comes. We must all be ready. We have to also let the world know and share the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. This text begins to help all of us to understand if that wine, if that oil, if that celebration happened, it happened because people had all the ingredients so that they could keep their lamps trimmed and burning. It is important for us to know that the Holy Spirit is represented as being that oil in our lives. It is through and by the power of the Holy Spirit that he keeps us. He allows us to keep our lamp shining. Remember, Jesus said, you are the light of the world. Therefore, don't go hide your light under a bushel, but let it shine. Oh, I remember that great song we used to sing. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm going to let it shine. All in my home, I'm going to let it shine. All at work, all at school, all at play, wherever I am, I'm going to let the light shine. My brothers and my sisters, may we let the light of the gospel shine in us. So then when the bridegroom comes, we can see and guide our way to where he is. Jesus said he is the light of this world. And if anyone comes to him, you'll never walk in darkness. Oh, I want to be ready for when the feast comes. It lets us see that those who were not ready, those who had not confessed their sins, those who had not embraced the love and the forgiveness of God, they were not able to get in. So my brothers and sisters, if you haven't done it, we ask that you would pray and receive Christ into your life today as your Lord and Savior. Then not only that, but make sure you have a place, someone who will pray with you, someone who will guide you along life's way. We love to be that place here at the Fountain. We love to be the person to walk with you as you have your walk with God. And if you would like to become a part of our ministry, we invite you to go to our website and you can go to the place where it says join. @thefountainofraleigh.org. It's an email address, join@thefountainofraleigh.org. And we will walk you through. We will welcome you into our fellowship and to our Christian community. Today, you might desire special prayer. We want to pray with you. You can go to pray@thefountainofraleigh.org and we'll pray with you because the Bible reminds us that the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. Now, I want to ask you, are you ready when he comes? If you're not ready, you can be. All you have to do is take a moment and do what I've just discussed with you. I want to pray with you that you'll be ready, that you'll know within your heart you have the assurance that you can make it into the wedding feast. You can make it into the celebration because you have done all that is needed and necessary. Let's pray together. My Father, I want to say thank you for these, my brothers and my sisters. We thank you that we can now call you our Father. So we ask right now that you would touch them. Those who need salvation, give it to them. Those who need healing of mind, body, and spirit. Father, those who have been dealing with COVID-19, those who have gone through different challenges in life, those who've had loved ones to pass on to be with you, bless them and keep them. And Father, we pray that your love will guide and keep us. Now, Lord, we commit it all to you, and we ask that you have your way. And it's in Jesus' name that we do pray. Amen, amen, and amen. I'm Pastor Anderson here at the Fountain of Raleigh Fellowship, where we believe God's blessings never stop flowing. We want to tell you we love you. We love you with the love of the Lord, and we'll look forward to worshiping and celebrating with you here at the Fountain, and I'll see you Monday morning for our Monday morning celebration. Let us now receive the benediction. Now unto him, the great shepherd, who gave his life for the sheep. May the Lord bless, preserve, and keep you from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. May he bless you in your leisure, in your labor, and your joys, and in your sorrows, and give you hope for today and tomorrow. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.
To sow a seed to the Fountain of Raleigh Fellowship, visit our newly redesigned website, thefountainofraleigh.org, and select Sow a Seed from the homepage. Also, giving has been made easier with the new Fountain of Raleigh app, available now in the Apple App Store and Google Play Store. Download today, select Giving from the main menu, and then follow the directions to complete your giving through Subsplash.
Thank you so very much for your prayerful support and all the things that we have done in ministry to help so many others. We thank you so very much for your generous support in times past, and we thank you for your present support and what you will do in the future. May God richly bless you, exceedingly and abundantly above all that you're able to ask, say, or think, according to his power at work in you. God bless you. Okay.